Okay, this sermon is entitled, Three Self-Perceived Perks of Lordship Salvation. I'd like to open up with prayer, and then with a few verses. All right, dear God, thank you for giving us your clear word. Thank you for allowing us to see what it says. Bless the listeners. I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Psalm 23 reads, The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Now, before I get into my notes, what is lordship salvation? Lordship salvation is this idea that instead of trusting in Christ alone as your Savior, these people teach that you have to submit to the lordship of God to make Christ your Lord and Master, rather than just accepting him as your Savior. And they teach that you have to repent of your sins and you have to obey the commandments. And there's lots of different variations and different nuances to lordship salvation. But nonetheless, these false prophets would never spell it out that way. But I've actually heard a lordshipper say that it wasn't enough that Jesus died on the cross for you. You have to make him Lord of your life. And that is utter blasphemy, and it's wicked as hell. And what is the causation of lordship salvation? I believe it just has to do with the simple fact that people are just full of pride, and they want others to notice them. It's this conspicuous consumption mentality. They want people to see what they've done and what they've accomplished. I call it the little engine that could mentality. And like I said, it's just rooted in pride. So number one, before I get into this, I've entitled this the three self-perceived perks of lordship salvation, because it's coming from their perspective. From the outside looking into this garbage, we don't see any perks. We don't see any benefits. It's all wickedness. It's all self-righteousness. But from their point of view, number one, the first perk is pride. They cultivate a illegitimate self-esteem from this. Turn over to Luke chapter 18. And let's take a look at verse 11, and it reads, The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank thee that I am not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. I fast twice in the week. I give tithes of all that I possess. And the publican, standing afar off, would not lift up so much as his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. On the one hand, we have the Pharisee, who's just bragging about all the things that he does, and, of course, what he doesn't do. You know, he tithes. He's not like this poor, sin-stricken publican. And we see the contrast in the publican. The publican's just admitting he's a sinner. So the first perk of lordship salvation is pride, and like I said, an illegitimate self-esteem. Number two, they have delusional assurance. They don't have any real assurance or any veritable assurance. They have this delusion. They're clinging to, you know, how they live and their works so that they can feel like they have some type of salvific assurance, when in reality they have none. Because God's not going to accept the proud. He's not going to accept the works of anybody. Because salvation is not of works, lest any man should boast. And then finally, number three, the final perk is they have the denunciation of sinners. They can blow the proverbial whistle on other people because they feel that others are more sinful than they. So like I said, there's actually no true benefits to this, because there's no salvation in this garbage, in this system. So number one, the first benefit is pride. Two, delusional assurance. And then three, they get to point the finger and judge others that they feel are just, you know, more wicked, when in reality, the Bible makes it clear that we're all equally wicked, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's no difference between how sinful people are in God's eyes. That's why we need to ditch this false teaching and trust in Jesus Christ alone. The Bible makes it very clear. He's the only one that could pay for our sins, and therefore we need to believe on him alone. He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. And once you believe on him, you're saved forever. And that's true salvation. Okay, salvation to the true saint is an event. Salvation to the unsaved, false prophet, lordship, damnationists is a process. It's never about anything that took place at one point in time. It's always about what they're currently doing. It's an ongoing vicious circle. And it leads to, you know, the pits of hell. That's all I have. Let me go ahead and close in prayer. Dear God, thank you for giving us your clear word. Thank you for allowing us to see what it says. Bless the listeners. I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.